Charles Elwood Chuck Yeager was born in Myra, West Virginia on February 13, 1923. It was a small town with a population of only around 97, and it was far away from most cities. He did not live there for long, though. During preschool, his family moved to the slightly larger town of Hamlin, West Virginia, which had a population of around 400. He grew up there, having a fascination with machines and how they worked. He loved hunting, fishing, mathematics, and anything requiring physical coordination and manual dexterity. His father, Albert Hal Yeager, owned a natural gas drilling company, which Chuck and his older brother helped with sometimes. He helped Chuck discover his love of machinery, which later helped him decide to join the military. He played football and basketball for Hamlin High School, and his best grades were in geometry and typing. He typed at 60 words per minute. All 19 of the graduates from his high school class went on to join the military, but of those 19, 9 or 10 later died in combat. Chuck later changed his mind and decided to become a pilot after the Army Air Force changed the regulations for becoming one. They saw that they weren't getting enough applicants, so they switched the requirements from needing a college education and being 20 years old to needing a high school education and being 18 years old. He earned his pilot wings after 6 months of training with Class 43C on March 10, 1943. While organizing a celebration for his squadron, he met his girlfriend and future wife, Glenna Stickhouse. He entered World War II with the 8th Air Force and the 363rd Fighter Squadron in England in 1944. He was assigned with a Mustang P-51B and he named it Glamorous Glennis after his fiancée. During his 8th combat mission on March 5, 1944, he was shot down over France by three Focke-Wulf 190s after destroying a German ME-109 the previous day. He had to wait a little bit before deploying his parachute out of fear that the FW-190s would shoot him out of the sky. When he landed, he realized he had sustained many injuries. He had a few bullet wounds, his hands and feet were injured from his plane, he had a large gash on his right calf, and he had a couple of scrapes on his head. He treated himself before moving on to find someone to help him. Chuck found a French farmer who, with the help of a silk map sewn inside his flight suit, led him to a resistance group called the Mackies in the neutral country of Spain on May 15, 1944. They helped him back to England after a month of travel. The day after he was shot down, his air group brought in bomber planes and bombed the Nazi capital of Berlin. About 70 of the planes were shot down. His request to return to combat went all the way up to the Supreme Allied Commander General Dwight Eisenhower and was accepted. He was the first of his squadron to be shot down and survived to make it back to England. Chuck finally returned to combat in August 1944, flying Glamorous Glennis II, which was a P-51C. He shot down an ME-109 in September 1944. Later, he upgraded to a P-51D named Glamorous Glennis III, which he used to achieve most of his aerial victories. He shot down five ME-109s on October 12, 1944, destroyed one and damaged two ME-262s on November 6, 1944, and shot down four FW-190s on November 27, 1944, making his total number of air victories an incredible 12.5. The .5 was for the two planes he damaged. His last World War II mission, which was his 64th mission, was on January 15, 1945. He flew as a spare pilot with his friend Andy. They decided to mess around that day, and they dropped their wing tanks to use them as ground targets for practice. Chuck was disappointed later after learning that that day, his squadron destroyed 57 German planes, and he didn't get to go along. He was promoted to captain during his World War II tour. He had completed 64 combat missions with a total of 270 flying hours. He encountered many challenges in four wars total, which were World War II, the Korean War, the Vietnam War, and with the Pakistani Air Force in the Indo-Pakistani War. After the war, NACA, later renamed NASA, became interested in Chuck Yeager as a potential candidate in the Mercury space mission program. Chuck wasn't planning on joining, since he didn't see it as flying, he saw it as simply riding in a capsule. NACA decided not to have him tested and trained anyways, though, because he did not have a college degree. He wasn't even disappointed. In 1947, when Chuck Yeager was 24, he explored supersonic flight by volunteering for the Bell X-1 test flight program. He was also involved in about 9 other test flight programs at the time and did not think much more about it than the others. The X-1 program started in January 1946 at Pinecastle Army Airfield in Orlando, Florida. It started because in World War II, when planes approached 80% of the speed of sound, they began to buffet and shake. Scientists wanted to know why this happened, so they started the X-1 test program. The X-1 was about 31 feet long, it had a wingspan of 28 feet, and a weight of 7,000 pounds when it did not have any fuel. It didn't use engines because at that time technology wasn't advanced enough to have engines with that much power. Chuck had his first glide flight in the X-1 on August 6, 1947. His first powered flight was on August 29th and he reached a speed of Mach 0.85. The ratio of a speed of an object compared to the speed of sound is called Mach, created and named after scientist Ernst Mach after photographing a supersonic bullet in 1881 and studying the speed of sound in 1887. For example, an object going half the speed of sound will be going at Mach 0.5, an object going the speed of sound will be going Mach 1, and an object going twice the speed of sound will be going Mach 2. Chuck flew multiple faster flights after his first powered one, but oddly his control stopped responding at Mach 0.94. Many people involved with the program believe that the reason was that the plane just simply stopped working because it was impossible to break the sound barrier. But during a later flight, the control issues were fixed by using the X-1 stabilizer to control climbing and descent instead of the elevator. Two nights before his most famous flight, Chuck was at Pancho Barney's Happy Bottom Riding Club with his wife, which was a popular place for the test pilots to hang out. It was a pub and club for horseback riders. He and his wife decided to ride for a while, and when they were going back to return the horses to their stables, it was dark and Chuck's horse hit a fence and flipped him over, breaking two of his ribs. This made it painful for him to get into his plane 2 days later on October 14th, 1947. That day, he broke the sound barrier and flew at a top speed of Mach 1.06, or 700 miles per hour, for 20 seconds. He was the first person to ever break the speed of sound, and previously, most people had thought it was impossible. The speed of sound changes based on altitude and temperature, and flying at supersonic speeds causes a cone-shaped shockwave to form behind the plane, releasing a large boom called a sonic boom. After Chuck Yeager broke the sound barrier, the US did not immediately release that they had. They wanted to keep it a secret from the USSR. Finally, in July 1948, it was released to the world that it most certainly was possible to break the speed of sound in a plane. Chuck was presented with the Collier Trophy, which was a trophy given for outstanding achievements that improve aircraft, from President Harry S. Truman in 1948. Also in 1948, he appeared on the cover of Time magazine and became an important spokesman for the Air Force. He was not the fastest man alive for long, though, because within a year of his legendary flight, a man in Britain had broken the sound barrier at a speed in between Mach 1 and 1.1. In May of 1953, he flew alongside of the first woman to break the speed of sound, which was Jacqueline Cochran. Chuck later flew in the X-1A, which was 7 feet longer than the X-1 and had double the fuel capacity for a much faster flight. One day while flying the X-1A, he had accidentally set the angle of his ascent to 65 degrees instead of the usual 45, and he was too busy working on regulating the pressure to notice. Eventually, it was too late, and he found himself 80,000 feet in the air, going at Mach 2.5, spinning 2 times per second. His plane began to rapidly fall, and while falling, his helmet hit the canopy and broke it open, which inflated his pressure suit. 51 seconds later, he finally pulled out of the rapid spin, now 51 miles away from his launch site and 25,000 feet in the air. He flew in many other test planes for the Bell X program, as well as other planes for the military and other wars. He trained and commanded multiple squadrons and retired at the rank of Brigadier General in 1975, but continued to serve as a consulting test pilot for many years. He received 8 military awards, which were the Purple Heart, the Bronze Star with V device, the Air Force Commendation Medal, the Silver Star with Oak Leaf Cluster, the Legion of Merit with Oak Leaf Cluster, the Distinguished Service Medal, the Distinguished Flying Cross with 2 clusters, and the Air Medal with 10 clusters. He was also awarded with the Medal of Freedom from President Ronald Reagan and the Congressional Gold Medal from President Gerald Ford, and was inducted into the Aviation Hall of Fame in 1973. Chuck Yeager was an amazing test pilot who exchanged his experiences for knowledge in many modern fields of science, an incredible air soldier, and undeniably one of the best members of the U.S. military ever.